And now it's my pleasure to introduce the artist who has her own beautiful rendition of it. Please welcome back to A Capital Fourth, Jackie Evancho.
And welcome to the Ed Boston Podcast Network. It's an Ed and Amy podcast night. Welcome to the show. I'm Ed and...
I'm Amy.
And we are glad to be here on the day after the 4th of July. I guess that would be the 5th of July, right?
Wow. I am so impressed.
Hey, math was one of my better subjects.
Evidently.
Welcome to the show. Glad you're here. Boy, do we have a lot to talk about tonight. Breaking news today. Hillary Clinton not going to be prosecuted. Let me add, for now, because in one of the audio clips I have, a certain person who I'll remain unnamed at this point says that if someone other than Hillary wins the White House, he actually says, if Trump wins the White House, that the statute of limitations will not have been out of date for the crimes that Hillary has committed, and that if that person has the guts to bring charges against her, it would still be possible after the new administration takes over. Oh, so for now, she is not being charged with anything.
Wow.
We will talk about that in depth later on in the show. I would ask you if you had a good fourth, but you've worked 87,000 hours in yes. the last week. So the fourth was just another work day for you, and it was an extra long work day for you.
It was. I did 15 hours that day. So, yeah, it was... Yeah, it was just another work day for me. No big deal.
Well, it's interesting because that special that Jackie Evancho just sang that song to, PBS got into some hot water because last night it was raining in Washington, D.C.
Right.
Thus, no fireworks. And they showed fireworks of previous years until people, well, they did it and they apologized when people figured out that certain pictures in the background just didn't make sense. Like right now, the Capitol building, they have scaffolding up because they're redoing some of the outside of the Capitol building.
Right.
Well, in the pictures in the fireworks, there was no scaffolding up. And different things like that that people could pick up on that showed that that wasn't a live fireworks scene. Now, my question is, why wouldn't they just say, it's raining in Washington, D.C., we're going to show fireworks from years past. Enjoy.
And why would people be that particular and complain of just because it wasn't a live fireworks show?
Well, I don't care what... Fireworks are fireworks to me.
Yeah, I mean, they're all the same. They go up in the air, they explode, things come out of them, they're ooh, ah, it's over with. I get that. So, how can you make any... what does it really make a difference? Last year's, this year's, 10 years ago?
Well, I think the difference it makes is that people, in general, this time, PBS, are comfortable with trying to deceive people.
Well, I agree that the TV station should have said what you said, that, you know, because of it raining, you know, we're going to show... But... Really? Does it make that big of a difference? Hillary can't go to jail, but they're going to persecute these people because they showed a rerun of fireworks. Really?
Well, and that doesn't take away from the beautiful, beautiful rendition of God Bless America that Jackie did. That was just awesome. I don't know if you noticed, she actually sang words that I didn't recognize. The first verse of God Bless America that never gets sang says this: while the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair as we raise our voices in a solemn prayer. And then that prayer is, God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. And that's written by Irving Berlin. Did you know those words, the first part?
Nope, I sure didn't.
And when I listened to it the first time, I was almost like, well, this has to be a version that nobody knows, because you could tell it was the sound of God Bless America. And so I dug up the actual lyrics and the part of the show that Jackie was in and all the other performers and everything, that was all live. You could see people in the audience with rain gear on, and there was no tomfoolery or whatever you want to say about that part. That was actually live. I seen posts that Jackie made backstage and different things like that. So what a great way to open the show. What a way to look at the day after the 4th of July. I get frustrated with the 4th of July because to me, my country means, it's way up there on the list of things that mean something important to me. It's not more important than God, and it's not more important than family, but it's right up there. And to me, people have hijacked the 4th of July, just like many other holidays have been hijacked, into something that it really isn't. Now, I know there's nothing wrong with having a good picnic on the 4th of July. I know there's nothing wrong with thousands of people getting together and watching a fireworks display and saying ooh and ah. And we didn't do that this year because of your work. But we both like a good fireworks show. It's not something that we're going to be depressed over, though, if we don't get to go to one. But I'm thinking about people when they're having their picnics, people when they're getting their day off of work with pay, when people are at the fireworks saying ooh and ah, are they really thinking about what was going on 240 years ago and how blessed we are as a nation to have the country that we have? And again, I say our holiday has been hijacked. Because I say that while at the same time saying I saw numerous Facebook posts and things of people that said freedom isn't free, God bless our troops, remembering them on this Independence Day. And you know, I've seen dozens of those, so I don't mean this inclusively of everyone, but I'm betting at your work yesterday, nobody said anything about God bless America.
Nope.
Nothing about Independence Day, I bet.
Nope.
Okay. Nothing about how God has blessed our nation.
No.
I bet you heard plenty of griping and complaining.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
I bet you heard a lot of people feeling like they were entitled to things.
Oh, well, that's every day, but yes, I heard a lot of that. You owe me, and yeah.
And so, this is kind of right up there with Christmas and Easter on holidays that have been hijacked for purposes other than what the holiday is meant for. And I can comfortably place those three together, even though Christmas and Easter are definitely Christian holidays.
Well, they started out that way.
Well, they're supposed to be Christian holidays.
Absolutely.
And I mean, just think about the amount of money that went up in smoke yesterday.
Unbelievable. And to me, that's one reason why I am not a fireworks fan. I think they're beautiful to watch. It just really, really irritates me knowing how much money is wasted every year on fireworks, not just from the huge displays, but the people that go out and buy fireworks and set off in their backyards and don't even give a second thought to all of the veterans, soldiers that may have PTSD. They don't give any thought to any animals that are scared to death of the sounds. They don't, the amount of money that is just wasted every 4th of July to me is so sad. It can go towards so many things for for the poor, for animal cruelty, for all these different things that are needy, and people just set it on fire.
Well, actually, Vanessa and I talked some about this last night on the wrestling show. You and I were traveling down the state road the other night, and we seen fireworks going off, and we were talking about, well, there's somebody just lit off a $5 bill.
Right, absolutely.
And we talked, too, about how more than likely a majority of the people that are burning those $5 bills are people that can't afford to burn those $5 bills.
Absolutely.
And people might want... We're watching... I'm talking about the fireworks that are in a show and go up and explode and look pretty and all that. Why do we do that? I mean, what's it representing? The rocket's red glare, the bomb's bursting in air? That's what it's supposed to be representing. And I'm not griping about it, but I just don't like things that are important to me being hijacked by things that aren't important.
I agree.
It's like the pastor that you was listening to his video today. What's his name?
Greg Locke.
Greg Locke, Pastor Greg Locke. And
he's amazing.
Amy loves him to death. He does YouTubes all the time. He'll pick a topic and he'll just give you his opinion for about 4 or 5 minutes. Or maybe even shorter. And he was talking about a piece in the New York Times where they were giving a theological explanation of something. It either had to do with Trump or it had to do with Republicans somehow, and you know, the other side, because we know that the New York Slimes is the ultra-liberal. Contrary to what Joy Behar said, the New York Slimes does not speak for most of America. believe you me, the New York Slimes does not speak for me.
Nor me.
And the Greg Locke was making the case of don't hijack my religion, my Christianity, my beliefs, by making a satire, basically, out of what it was that they were talking about. He said, how dare they, when they're not Christian, they put down all Christian values, and then they're going to act like they know what Christians think and do and say and how they ought to be.
And he talked about how they cherry-picked what they wanted out of the Bible to where it would be beneficial to what they were saying.
Mm-hmm.
And then take it completely out of context.
So that's why I have an issue with the 4th of July. Don't hijack something that's so important to me as my country. That's why I get upset on things like Veterans Day and Memorial Day. You know, people just use those as
Memorial Day, especially as
a three-day weekend.
Right.
They get the day off, just like they get 4th of July off. They didn't sacrifice nothing, probably. Maybe they did. Maybe they've had relatives that fought in wars, but the majority haven't.
Right.
The majority sacrificed nothing, and they still get...
Well, the holiday is not celebrated for what the holiday is. It's not being portrayed for what it's supposed to be portrayed for. It's being portrayed as a party weekend where you can have cookouts and all this. That's not what those weekends are for.
And I guess Veterans Day gets me even more because it's a federal holiday. Federal employees get the day off, whether they're veterans or not veterans.
Right.
you know, I don't know how you manage it differently, but let's reward veterans on Veterans Day. And not federal employees that may hate veterans.
Absolutely.
Quite possibly hate veterans. You know, retail. They use those examples to have great big sales. You know, this car lot, we have a Memorial Day sale. You know, prices lower than ever before. Well, do you really believe that?
No.
Okay, thank you. I don't have to sell you any land or any property or anything like that. And
boy, it's early in the show and you're wound up.
Oh, you wait.
Oh, heavens.
You wait. Oh, I've got lots of sound clips to help me tonight. I don't have to do all the talking. We got good stuff to talk about, things that we should be excited about.
I know what I'm excited about.
What are you? Oh, I know what you're excited about. Our anniversary.
Absolutely.
2 years.
Yep.
Thursday.
And you haven't killed me yet.
I haven't killed you yet.
It's because I'm always at work. You never see me.
Well,
that's probably why you haven't killed me yet.
I'm thinking that's probably not the reason. But I will agree with you. I haven't killed you. And you say yet.
Yet.
I haven't killed you. You haven't killed me.
And that's been tough.
I think you wanted to in your dreams last night.
Yes, that I did. I sure did.
I'm lucky I didn't wake up this morning with your hands around my neck.
Yeah.
You need to quit having dreams like that.
I don't dream very often, but when I do, boy.
Well, you do it upright.
Yes, I do.
Trevor just sent a message that said he just heard from Sam Haskell.
No way!
And he said to tell everybody hello, so... Hello awesome. Out there, everybody, from hello. Sam Haskell.
Absolutely.
And hello back to Sam if he's listening tonight.
We love Sam.
Or later. We do love Sam. And he is a great friend of the show. He's one of those guys that just... I'm glad Trevor put that in there. It gave me a chance to take a breath.
Good.
Because I'm going to need all the oxygen I've got a little bit later on.
Uh-oh.
Well, it just has to be one of them days. And, I mean, the day after the 4th of July, the celebration of independence, 240 years of American history, and the day after, Hillary Clinton gets cleared. Well, the thing is, she... she doesn't get cleared... She's just not going to get charged because the guy actually put forth plenty of evidence that's damning to her cause. We'll listen to a clip later that kind of just says you need to forget all of that and vote for Hillary because I say you should.
Wow.
Not I, Ed Boston, but you'll hear who says that later on. But let's go into something that Christians should be celebrating. You know, this show is from a Christian perspective. How about this? 200,000 Buddhists convert to Christianity.
Wow. Amen.
That's something.
That's awesome.
And speaking of converting to Christianity and awesome, before I go on with this story... And I won't forget it. It's right up here in front of my face. We had something to celebrate at Good Shepherd Worship Center this weekend, didn't we?
We absolutely did, and it was an honor. It was a good honor.
You can go to edboston.com and look at the recent videos. It's the first one up. And see that we baptized a lady here.
We sure did.
On Sunday, and what a day it was.
It was awesome.
We had the most in attendance that we've had in... weeks, and it was just a glorious day, not because of us, and not even because of Good Shepherd Worship Center, but because God's work was being done.
Absolutely. And God got a newborn child in his
I was just
family and...
I was just so excited to be a part of such an event.
It was awesome.
It's always an honor. So you can go to edboston.com and take a look at that baptism if you would like. It's all the pre, the baptism, and the post. And it's not very long. It's,
mine is getting to eat all the cake, which we had plenty of that, and it was really good.
Yes, we did have some good cake and punch.
Yes, and
that brings up another whole story that we could go into. We'll save it for another time. The famous Walmart...
Oh, heavens.
...cake story. It's a classic. But we're on past the that part of the show.
Once again, no one died, though.
Yeah, no one... I was concerned. I was very happy to get you home and into bed that night and get you to sleep because
Yes. You
were about to snap on something or somebody, and I was the last somebody that you saw. So I was a little on the nervous side.
It's probably a good thing I had that dream last night and not that
yeah,
night.
Yeah, it probably is. 200,000 Tibet Buddhists gave their life to Jesus at a revival... All the revival needed was the first spark of a Tibetan monk. When he converted to Christianity last year, the revival fire exploded. Now more than 200,000 Tibetans have accepted Jesus into their lives, according to multiple reports. Asian Access's Joel Hanley says he believes much of the faith sweeping the religion stems from Christian response to the devastating Nepalese earthquake more than a year ago. Quote, they haven't seen Buddhists, Hindus, or other religious groups helping in the midst of the rubble. Rather, week after week, it's the followers of Jesus who have proved the test of time, sacrificed their own lives to serve and bend the hands and feet of Jesus, Hanley says. And that's the case so many of the times. Disasters all around the world, America steps up. And they're not the only ones. Other countries do too. But Americans, and it's usually in the form of Christian organizations.
Right.
And I'm not saying it's all Christian organizations, so don't put words in my mouth. But Christian organizations like this. Asian Access wants to build the kingdom of God throughout Asia using local leaders, according to their website. I pulled this story from trevordecker.com, so if you want to read the entire story, you can go there. Again, trevordecker.com, and the headline you'd be looking for is 200,000 Buddhists convert to Christianity. To keep on that same theme, on the edboston.com website, down in the Christian news area, actually, I think, let me see, yeah, this is CBN, one of the three outlets we use for Christian news at edboston.com. Get this headline, Europe is alive for Jesus. Revival breaks out in France. Amid the ongoing threat of Islamic terror and economic instability, thousands of people in France are giving their lives over to Christ. People from all over Europe flocked to Nates, N-A-T-E-S, France last week to seek the Lord at the Grand Conference. The purpose of the conference this year was to call an increasingly secular Europe back to a true relationship with God. The key phrase of the conference was, "Mercy triumphs over judgment," a banner declaring God's ability to heal and restore Europe. Chris Gore, a minister from Bethel Church in California, spoke at the event and has posted about it on Facebook. He says hundreds of people encountered the gospel and surrendered their hearts to Christ. The first session of the conference, over 70% of over 1,000 people gave their lives to Jesus for the first time.
Wow.
The hope of this nation is the gospel. Not only did hundreds of people give their lives to Christ, thousands more experienced life-changing miracles. Europe is alive for Jesus. What an incredible night in France. We saw tonight around 2,000 miracles and exactly 100 reports of deaf ears opening. Greg posted along with a video of an auditorium full of people praising God. And this story is up. It's still currently up on edboston.com. If you're listening to this archive down the road, you can go to CBN and type in Europe is Alive for Jesus in the search, and I'm sure you'll be able to come up with it from the CBN news source. God's not dead.
God's not dead. We know that.
And he's surely alive. And the stories that are coming from all over the world about people turning their lives over to Christ at the same time when we complain that things are going to hell in a handbasket here in the United States of America, which might be true in some ways. We still have the greatest country in the world, I believe. We need to hold on to it, but I'm looking for something here real quick. I was trying to find something in my... you know, I'm such an off-the-cuff person, and I did more show prep today than I've done in ages.
I know. The day that I'm off, and you spent zero time with me.
No, that's not true. I sit right here beside you the whole day.
Did you speak to me the whole day?
Some.
No.
Yes, I did. Fibbing's not attractive.
Okay, did you speak to me more than maybe 10 minutes? No.
Okay, now don't get too technical on me. but in the midst, I'm so random with grabbing stuff that I never thought about having this clip ready to go. It would be perfect for right now. And then, of course, things aren't where I think they ought to be in my files. And then that is that. So I would like to report revival here in America. And there is revival here in America. It's the problem is we hear more about the negatives than we do the positives. And maybe we're part of the problem. Maybe we report on more of the negatives than we do the positives. And I try to work on that, to have a portion of the show dedicated to feel-good things and things that are going right. And when you give stories like a nation being on fire for Christ and 200,000 of a different religion converting to Christianity, that's things to talk about. And I love when we can say God's not dead. And I was just thinking about another time recently when I was talking with somebody about that, and it was when I talked with Brad Mathias about the Eyeshine group and the rubies and things like that. And he was talking about young people, and most of the time people give young people a hard time and think that the young generation is totally lost and don't know anything. And he said, I'd be happy to talk about the good part of that, and went on to tell stories about how we can figure out that there's a lot of good coming out of the young people of today. And so it makes me happy to be able to report on those things. I wish that it was that way for the entire... I wish that I could go without bringing up some of the stuff I'm going to bring up today. People probably think I like those kind of stories because I get fired up about them. And I get fired up about them because they irritate me so bad, because it's about my country that I love. And you know, God bless America. God's blessed America over and over and over. And I want him to keep blessing America. I want our kids and our grandkids and our great-grandkids to be, to have the same blessings that we had when we were growing up.
I agree.
And so that's why I have to report on things that I don't even want to talk about. I don't enjoy talking about Hillary Clinton not going to jail when she should. That's not my idea of a good time. My idea of a good time would not ever include the name Hillary Clinton.
Unless she is going to jail.
I mean, that's just a fact. And so
I want to work at the jail she goes to.
You want to go? Oh, now I'm laughing. Well, I said earlier, God's not dead, right?
That's right. He's surely alive.
You repeated that.
Yep.
God's not dead.
Revival. Let heaven roar.
Ah, now I feel better.
Love it.
God's not dead. He's sure. I love the Newsboys. I love the old version of the Newsboys. I love the new version of the Newsboys. They just do something for me that thrills my soul. And it's a good thing God's not dead. Because we have to fight the good fight. And we have to watch out for things like this. The former Pope admits there's a gay lobby influence in the Vatican.
Oh my heavens.
Former Pope Benedict says in his memoirs that no one person pressured him to resign, but alleges that a gay lobby in the Vatican had tried to influence decisions, a leading Italian newspaper reported on Friday. This is an older story. The book called The Last Conversations is the first time in history that a former pope judges his own pontificate after it is over. It is due to be published in September. Citing health reasons, Benedict in 2013 became the first pope in six centuries, 600 years, that's a long time.
That's a long time.
To resign. He promised to remain hidden to the world and has been living in a former convent in the Vatican Gardens. Let's see. The church has maintained its centuries-long opposition to homosexual acts, but rights campaigners have long said many gay people work for the Vatican, and church sources have said they suspect that some have banded together to support each other's careers and influence decisions in the bureaucracy. Benedict, who now has the title Emeritus Pope, has always maintained that he made his choice to leave freely, and a reporter says that in the book, Benedict again denies blackmail or pressure. He says he told only a few people close to him of his intention to resign, fearing it would be leaked before he made the surprise announcement in February of 2013. The former pope, in the book-long interview with German writer Peter Seewald, says he had to overcome his own doubts on the effect his choice could have on the future of the papacy. He said he was incredulous when cardinals meeting in secret conclave chose him to succeed Pope John Paul II in 2005, and that he was surprised when the cardinals chose Francis as his successor in 2013. Anger over the dysfunctional state of the Vatican bureaucracy in 2013 was one factor in the cardinals' electors' decision to choose a non-European pope for the first time in nearly 1,300 years.
Wow.
Benedict admits his lack of resoluteness in governing, the reporter says. In the book, whose lead publisher is German's Dromer Knarr, Benedict says he kept a diary throughout his papacy but will destroy it, even though he realizes that for historians, it would be a golden opportunity. Wonder why he thinks he needs to destroy it.
I don't know. It sounds a little odd.
In the book, Benedict also says he came to know of the presence of a gay lobby made up of four or five people who were seeking to influence the Vatican's decisions. The article says Benedict says he managed to break up this power group. So he stood up to him.
Yes, he did.
I'm going to guess that the current pope does not stand up to them. Again, we reported last week that Jack Van Impe was going to do a special over the weekend that had to do with 10 things that the Pope has done against the church. There was some issues with that, and it's going to be released this weekend, I'm told, so I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say on that topic. The You know, I don't know if people like Jack Van Impe, don't like Jack Van Impe. He's very, very knowledgeable.
Never heard of Jack Van Impe?
Yeah, some people never heard of Jack Van Impe. He's extremely knowledgeable on end times prophecy. And so whether you like him or you don't like him is neither here nor there when it comes to the fact that he is bold enough to stand up and talk about, you know, the Pope is always kind of one of those off limits topics. You know, you can't put down the Pope. He's the Pope.
He's the Pope.
And so once we get Van Impe's video, we'll post it for you to be able to see. We'll talk about it whenever it comes out. Supposed to be this weekend. And I'm sure that I'll be at the minimum saying bravo for his courage, because mm-hmm. that's one of the things that I preach on here, is that Christians have got to have the courage to stand up for what we believe in and not be afraid of the liberal bias that there is out there against us.
Absolutely.
And, you know, no pussyfooting around with it. I mean, that's just what it is. Liberal bias and hate that comes from the left against Christians and people that have any kind of morals is utterly ridiculous. And speaking of that, I titled this show, let me see if I get it right here. Let me see if it tells me where it tells me. I know where I can find it. I'll find it on Facebook. I want to read the title, and I want to read it accurately.
Well, you know, if it's on Facebook, it's gospel.
I wrote it, so that's why it's on Facebook, silly. Yeah, but you're stealing my line. I use that regularly. You know,
sorry.
If it's on Facebook, it's got to be true.
I didn't know it was something.
Yeah, thanks a lot, dear. Yes, it is something that I...
Well, good... then you know it's got to be gospel.
No, I don't. No, I don't. The title of this show is Good Politics, Bad Politics, Farage and Clinton. And tonight, for the description, I say, tonight we will look at an example of good politics, Nigel Farage, and that of bad politics, Hillary Clinton, that and more on the Ed Boston Podcast Network. So I want to get into this. Oh, I have one story left before we get into this. We talk a lot about radical Islam and the violence that they do. And I don't know if a lot of people realize this, but a lot of the violence that takes place is Muslim-on-Muslim violence. There are two different major sects within the Muslim religion, Sunnis and Shiites. And no, I didn't cuss. Sunnis and Shiites. And they hate each other about as bad as they hate Israel and America. I mean, they literally detest each other. And, you know, Ramadan is their sacred and holy month, and, you know, they get a whole month of, you know, we take Easter weekend, we'll even take credit for Holy Week, but they take a whole month of Ramadan, and the radical part of Islam uses Ramadan as a reason to blow people up, basically. And I wanted to play this story from CBN talking about a bunch of violence that took place this last week across the Middle East during the last few days of Ramadan. Let's listen to CBN.
Thank you so much for joining us for CBN Newswatch. I'm Ephraim Graham. Terrorists have been attacking across the Islamic world, hitting hard from Iraq to Saudi Arabia. One suicide bomber targeting a U.S. diplomatic site, another explosion rocking one of Islam's holiest sites. As Charlene Aaron reports, it's all part of a series of radical Islamic terrorist attacks as Ramadan wraps up.
The attack in the Saudi Arabian city of Jeddah near the U.S. consulate took place Monday after a suicide bomber detonated explosives when security guards approached him near the parking lot of a hospital. The U.S. Embassy in Saudi Arabia confirmed there were no casualties or injuries among the consular staff. Suicide bombed other cities, including a blast outside of one of Islam's holiest sites in Medina, killing four Saudi security forces and wounding five others. The Mosque of Muhammad was packed on Monday evening with worshipers during the final days of the Muslim holy month of Ramadan, which ends in the kingdom on Tuesday. Millions of Muslims from around the world visit the mosque every year as part of their pilgrimage to Mecca. Saudi Arabia is part of the U.S.-led coalition fighting ISIS in Iraq and Syria. ISIS considers the Saudi ruling monarchy as an enemy. The kingdom has been the target of multiple attacks by the group that have killed dozens of people. In June, the Interior Ministry reported 26 terror attacks in the last 2 years. Meanwhile, Iraqi authorities say more dead bodies have been recovered from the site of the massive weekend suicide bombing in central Baghdad.
We are still searching for bodies. Today we were able to exhume remains, and we will continue searching for human remains at the scene. We found documents and mobile phones belonging to victims.
The bombing early Sunday in a busy shopping district was the deadliest single attack in Iraq in years, killing at least 200 people. The bombing shows the ISIS capability for launching attacks beyond the front lines, despite battlefield losses elsewhere in the country. Charlene Aaron, CBN News.
So we have to look at ISIS as a two-part issue and problem. There's the problem that's taken place in Iraq and Syria, where it's like a battlefield and one side's fighting the other side, and you know, you know who's versus who most of the time. I mean, it's not like they're wearing ISIS uniforms and things like that, but there's the battlefield side, but then there is this other side of ISIS, and ISIS is losing on that front right now.
Wow, that's too bad.
And that's what Obama always wants to talk about. He wants to talk about that. But ISIS is going around the world, blowing people up, blowing themselves up, thinking that they're going to get virgins. And they don't limit it to the United States. They don't limit it to Europe. I mean, they're blowing people up across the Middle East. And it's a horrible problem, and it's something that hopefully our next president will take a little more seriously. And I'm sorry for people who will disagree with me on that, but we have not taken ISIS seriously. Obama's called them the JV team from a long time ago. Boy, I bet he wishes he hadn't have made that remark.
I don't think he feels bad about any remarks he made.
Well, he got made to look stupid.
Well, but that's a given. He opened his mouth.
Speaking of being made to look stupid, this story has nothing to do about anything. But Will you quit that? Not you. My phone.
Turn your volume down.
I thought it did. It was. So this is the story that has no importance to it at all. It's just funny. You know how politicians use teleprompters?
Right.
Not just politicians, but politicians use them.
Right.
Hillary Clinton was reading from a teleprompter, and it got to a point where they were coaching her to let out a large sigh, like,
you know. They have to coach
that,
you to
that's
do
a,
that.
A sigh.
Oh, my goodness.
And so she was reading, and it got to where it said, sigh.
And she said sigh.
And she read sigh.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh.
Now, see, I could actually do something like that.
Now, why would you have to prompt someone to sigh?
Well,
if
I'm
it
sure
was a genuine reaction, it should already be there. But you're having to be told how to even react.
Well, I'm sure it doesn't matter what political side you're on, that those teleprompters give you a lot more to do than what you ought to have to worry about. And I could picture myself doing the same thing, you know, like reading off of a sermon script or something like that. But I don't think I'd prompt myself to sigh.
Wow. That's hilarious.
Well, that's a good way to end the first hour of the show is...
by making Hillary look stupid. Well, it's awesome. Well, I mean, you didn't make her. She did herself.
I was
going to
say, I can't make that stuff up.
No.
You know, that almost sounds like one of those jokes. You know, Hillary Clinton was giving a speech the other day.
She walked into a bar with...
There was Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama, and a bum sitting at a bar. No, no, no. That's not what we're doing. Okay. We're actually to the point of the show where it's good politics, bad politics. And we're going to start with...
bad politics?
No. Oh. Good politics.
I figured we'd end on the good.
Well, we'll end with something good, but... good politics is going to come first. We have talked quite extensively on the show about Nigel Farage ever since the Brexit topic has been such a huge topic all over the world.
I just love his name.
Nigel Farage.
It just sounds so sophisticated.
Nigel Farage. And then if I actually had a British accent, it would probably even sound more sophisticated.
I'd love to hear him say his name.
Well, he made a major announcement this week. And it's not what people would think of a politician to do.
Well, make a major announcement.
No. What his major announcement was.
Oh.
You know, most people think politicians get into politics, stay into politics the rest of their life. Rightfully so. You know, there's people that have been serving for decades. And Nigel served for a long time.
Right.
But Nigel Farage has announced he will stand down as the leader of the UK Independence Party, the UKIP, saying, "I've done my bit to get Britain out of the European Union." He said UKIP was in a good position following the EU referendum and that his political ambition had been achieved. "I came into this struggle from business because I wanted us to be a self-governing nation, not to become a career politician," Farage said. Now, he's probably at his strongest position in his life right now.
Probably.
And he's stepping out of the limelight. Well, I don't know if he's going to step out of the limelight or not, but he's stepping out of the political limelight at a time where he could really use that to his benefit.
Right.
In a tweet, he said, "Thank you to all my supporters in UKIP and beyond. Delighted with the result we fought for so long to achieve. Hashtag Brexit Britain." That article is up over at trevordecker.com, and I wanted to play this soundbite from Nigel.
I have never been, and I've never wanted to be, a career politician. My aim in being in politics was to get Britain out of the European Union. That is what we voted for in that referendum 2 weeks ago. And that is why I now feel that I've done my bit, that I couldn't possibly achieve more than we managed to get in that referendum. And so I feel it's right that I should now stand aside as leader of UKIP. I will continue to support the party. I will support the new leader. I will watch the renegotiation process in Brussels like a hawk, and perhaps comment in the European Parliament from time to time. I'm also very keen to help the independence movements that are springing up in other parts of the European Union, because I'm certain of one thing: you haven't seen the last country that wants to leave the EU. It has been a huge chunk of my life doing this, and it's not easy, perhaps when you feel a degree of ownership of something, to let it go. But it does come, as I say, at a cost, has come at a cost to me and perhaps to those around me. During the referendum campaign, I said, I want my country back. And what I'm saying today is I want my life back. And it begins right now. Thank you.
Must be nice to go out on top.
Well, absolutely.
I always like it in sports when somebody retires, when something good happens, and they don't stay around until they're old and washed up and people are making fun of them. Well, you know, old for athletes is about 35, so maybe 40.
Yeah. You're right.
So, and again, how different that is than what your typical politician would be. He could use what happened in the last few months, and he will in his private life, I'm sure. I'm sure that he's not going to hurt for anything, or, you know, he was...
But you know what? He's not doing it in a cocky, arrogant way.
Yeah, I mean, the cockiest he sounds is, I want my life back starting right now, you
right,
know?
Right.
And that's just humor. And you're right, I'm glad you brought that up. That's one of the things that I really, really like about him, and that probably a lot of people in Britain would say the opposite, that he's cocky and arrogant, but he doesn't come across to me as being cocky and arrogant.
See, and I don't think he does either at all.
I mean, all we have to do is look at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue for cocky and arrogance in a politician.
Absolutely.
And we're going to hear from Mr. 1600 here in just a few minutes. And actually, the headline says, An Arrogant Obama.
Now, see, that was almost like you had prompted me to say that remark, and you did not.
I didn't. I had no prompting at all. And we're going to look at that. But I don't want to leave without just congratulating Nigel on setting a goal.
Right.
And it wasn't no little goal. It wasn't like I'm going to set a goal of doing 50 push-ups.
Absolutely. I mean, he went for the gold there.
You know, that was almost like setting a goal of being able to do 1,000 push-ups.
Right.
You know, not 50 push-ups. You know, doing push-ups for 3 hours straight or something without taking a breath.
I agree.
Well, okay, he'd have to breathe, but you know what I'm saying. That was no little goal, and he's a lesson in perseverance and sticking to what you believe. You know, he didn't give up all the different times he had setbacks.
Right.
And he knows when it's time to leave. Too many people don't know when it's time to leave.
Bad company.
Yeah, now, together we work as a team to get each other out of positions like that, having bad company, and we prompt things like, it's time to start the show, I gotta go.
Get off the phone.
So, Does your mom and dad listen to the show?
Yes, once in a while they do.
Well, if they do, then they'll know what you did before the show today.
It's all right.
You love your mom and dad, though, don't you?
Oh, with all my heart.
Okay, thank you. Next.
Thanks a lot there, dear.
Did I bust you?
I'm not as much as I'm going to bust you.
I think inside of her brain, she just took the fifth. Not took a fifth, but took the fifth.
Not took a fifth?
You're right.
Darn it.
So we've got good politics. And I hope there's books out about Nigel and different things that we can learn more about him. Of course, we may not like him as much if we learn more about him, but what I know about him, I like him very much and respect very much.
Right.
But then, there's also the bad politics. And I have sound bites galore of things from today's today's happenings, but I want to play first a spot from a former Navy SEAL who has a little bit of an investment in what went on in Benghazi and what he has to say about the potential of a Hillary Clinton presidency.
My name is Chris Peronto, call sign Tonto. I was with the Global Response Staff. We were the security element for the Central Intelligence Agency in Benghazi, Libya on 9/11/2012. Myself and my team responded to an attack that killed Ambassador Chris Stevens, Sean Smith, and two of my teammates, Tyrone Woods and Glenn Doherty. Radical Islam is basically terrorism in a nutshell. It wants to not only put down Western values, it wants to kill anybody that supports those Western values, which is freedom, which is Christianity, and which is also anything that looks poorly on Sharia law. We've allowed it again to grow into something that it shouldn't be. And it's becoming stronger and stronger every day that we don't lead from the front. Obama and Hillary, by avoiding the phrase radical Islam, they're being politically correct. They don't see it for what it is. And that's straight up destroying the Western world. Radical Islam doesn't have a fear. They will give up their lives. They will detonate themselves. They will do anything they can to fulfill Sharia law and kill the infidels. If we're not able to even say radical Islam, the word radical Islam, there's no way we can fight it. There's no way we can defeat it. The United States of America doesn't lead from behind. We are always setting the example. If not, we're going to see terrorism get bigger and bigger, and eventually it's just going to be continual lone wolf attacks in the United States. And I don't want that to happen to my kids. I don't want to see my family go through that. Please join me in waking up Washington in this fight on radical Islam, seeing the threat that it really is. Sign up at leadingfromthefront.org.
Now, see, that's somebody that I can respect what they say because they've been in the, what some people call, been in the suck. He was there in Benghazi. He was the one, his group was the one that went in and helped finally put an end to what was going on there. And we get, well, the arrogance of the left. There was nothing arrogant about that statement at all. Just stating fact. And if you don't think it's fact, that then you're wrong. It's not whether you're left or right. It's just you're wrong. Radical Islam wants to destroy the West.
Absolutely.
They would only be happy if they were the only ones on the face of the earth, and then they still wouldn't be happy, I'm sure. But that would be what their goal would be, to wipe out anybody who doesn't believe the way they do. And again, if you don't believe that to be fact, you're wrong. I can't say it any more plain. Right. And I'm not saying it arrogantly. I'm just saying that's the way it is.
Right.
It is what it is, and that's it. Now, I was on here the other night, and I was highly upset that Hillary Clinton is even running, has the audacity to run for president.
Well, that's an understatement there.
And I've made it plain that my political purpose for this presidential election is no Hillary Clinton in the White House by whatever means necessary that's legal. And for right now, what my job is to do is to expose her for what she is, a fraud, a liar, and unqualified to be the commander-in-chief. You'll find out throughout the next 40 minutes or so that some other people that will give you... You're going to hear on this show a clip that says Hillary Clinton could not qualify for a security clearance based upon the evidence that was put out today by the FBI director. Now, let me tell you, I had a top secret SI clearance when I was in the Army. I'm not bragging. That's just a fact. That's just, I'm stating that for a fact.
Right.
I know that I had to go through a background check.
Right.
I know that the feds were in my neighborhood questioning people because I heard about it. They were looking into my background. I wasn't old enough to have anything too horrible. You know, for a white boy that come from the Midwest that didn't get out of Columbus, Indiana a whole lot except for going on vacation and playing sports, you know, there wasn't a whole lot that they could have found. They probably thought, is anybody ever going to say anything bad about this guy? They could have asked one neighbor. You know, I told you about the one neighbor.
I was going to say, little did they know, there was nothing negative they could have found.
But, so I know a little bit about the top secret sensitive information. I know a little bit about that.
Right.
And you're going to hear where she's wants to be the commander-in-chief of the United States of America. However, she would not qualify to get a security clearance. That's embarrassing.
Very embarrassing.
Must not embarrass her, because they didn't even take the day off from their arrogance, and I don't even know how to describe them. We'll listen to that in a little bit, but let's talk first about no charges for Hillary.
Correspondent Catherine Herridge is joining us now. Catherine, nobody knows this story better than you do. Tease apart some of the details for us. What stands out to you?
Well, sure. The first thing that stands out to me is that the FBI director began by saying that he had not coordinated his statement with anyone within the administration. And then he gave a 15-minute statement of their findings and no questions. And that is very unlike the director. He typically leaves it open to reporters to ask questions. He said that they found 58 email chains which contained classified information at the time that they hit that server. Some of them were sent by Mrs. Clinton. And he also indicated that there were emails that were recovered that did contain these classified markings, though Mrs. Clinton has publicly said nothing was marked classified at the time. The director went on to say that someone in her position and the others around her should have recognized the sensitivity of the information that they were handling, and that would go into this bucket of 793F, which is gross negligence, where you don't have to show intent. He then went on to say that based on their investigation, I think Morgan Wright just addressed this, that they have to assume that this information was accessed by third parties, even hostile nations, because the server was not set up with the kind of security you would even find in a government system. But he said, based on the totality of the evidence, he did not think that this was a case that a prosecutor would pursue. So he laid out what his investigators have found in the last 15 months, what they found to be the negligent handling of classified information. His word was careless, and that they should have known better, even though it was not marked, and that it was in the hands of a third party. But even based on that, he did not think that this was the type of case that a prosecutor would bring, because the cleanest kind of case for a prosecutor is where they show willingness or willfulness or intent, and he did not believe that that was the case here, John.
One of his quotes, there is evidence they, meaning she and her State Department, were extremely careless in their handling classified information. Okay. Catherine Herridge, I'm sure.
And what I would just, if I could just one last point, if I could.
Yes.
If you look at 18 U.S.C. 793, subsection F, there is gross negligence is gross negligence. There's no requirement for intent or willfulness in that action. And if there had been an opportunity to ask questions, the question really would be, what would the director say to government security clearance holders who have been prosecuted and jailed for so much less in similar cases, John?
Fines, fined under this title or imprisoned not more than 10 years or both, the statute right. goes on to say. Catherine Herridge. Catherine, I'm sure you have a lot of work to do. Thanks very much for sharing some time with us today.
You're welcome.
Okay, we heard a lot there. We heard that she's a liar because she said that nothing was marked as being classified, whatever the classification was. That's a lie. We actually need the soundbite of what's the one guy who does the lie detector tests and, you know, the talk show host that does the lie detectors.
Oh, Maury.
Maury, yeah, we need a soundbite of Maury Povich. We'll say a statement, and we'll have Maury Povich say, we determined that was a lie.
Exactly.
How did we determine that was a lie? Because the Attorney General, who had investigators working on this for 15 months, uncovered the fact that that was a lie. We look at the fact that she... did things much less, I mean, much more. People have been sent to jail and other punishments for much less than what she did. They've been put to jail. Petraeus, when he supposedly passed some information on to his girlfriend, you know, he got into trouble. I've heard, and I think it's in one of the clips later, where this information, not things that are made up by people that are, you know, conspiracies and all of that. I'm talking about just the things that the FBI director laid out today. People have been imprisoned, fined, punished for much less than what she has been found of doing, and yet no charges.
Makes no sense.
Being extremely careless with classified information. Extremely careless in email scandal. But no charges, according to FBI director. And looking back at our investigations into mishandling or removal of classified information, we cannot find a case that would support bringing criminal charges on these facts. Are you kidding me? I seen a Facebook post today by a person that I know. He lives in Las Vegas, Nevada. His brother, I worked for about 3 years. And he said that he almost got an Article 15, which is military reprimand that takes money out of your pocket and goes in your permanent file, for looking doing a job search on a government computer for jobs in Las Vegas when he was getting ready to get out of the military.
Wow.
Anybody that has been in a position of handling classified information knows the do's and the don'ts. It's not even a question. And she exposed national security information to hackers, to foreign governments, basically anybody that wanted,
right,
wanted them, because she didn't even have the smarts to put the proper safety precautions in place to make sure she didn't get hacked. So not only did she mishandle, but she gave away secrets. I mean, she didn't exactly just, you know, go up to him and say, here, have it. But she might as well have.
Well, absolutely.
You know, that's extreme negligence. That's where absolutely the extreme negligence comes. And that's no excuse under law. It's never been an... If you're driving down the road and you're doing 70 in a 55... and the police officer pulls you over, and you say, I didn't see the 55-mile-an-hour speed limit sign. Is he going to say, well, okay, I'll just let you go?
Nope.
If it's a state trooper, he's probably going to write your butt a ticket.
Yep.
If it's a local guy, maybe you can get out of it. But you see why I'm so frustrated? I mean, this guy says, however, he also stated that Clinton was extremely careless after finding 110 emails sent or received contained classified information. Anyone hostile to the United States could have accessed them through hacking. This happened after Bill Clinton meets with the Attorney General in a secret meeting in an airplane.
Yeah, doesn't that sound just suspicious?
I'm going to go out and say, what if he had a briefcase with $1 million in it,
exactly,
and handed it to her? I don't know that he did. I'm not accusing him of. I'm just saying, what if?
You don't know that he didn't.
I don't know that he didn't. It's extremely suspicious.
Absolutely.
It's suspicious enough that she said she was going to turn over the decision-making to career Justice Department officials, career FBI officials. And then just days later, we have an FBI director, James Comey, that goes against everything that makes sense. It doesn't make sense that you would put out all this evidence. There's one person I keep referring to that said he thought that Comey was going to come out and say that she was being charged. Because he put out all the evidence,
right,
and then said, but we're not going to charge her. I mean, and the person I'm talking about is a politician, but his background is in being a prosecutor. We want a commander-in-chief that is extremely careless with classified information.
And then plays ignorant.
Yeah, lies.
Know.
Lies.
Right.
Whatever she does, she gets by with. She lies, and then her Teflon tail will not stick to anything.
Yeah, exactly.
And she wants to be commander-in-chief. It makes me sick to my stomach that my country may be led by the biggest fraud of all time for a second presidency. Because there's never been a bigger fraud than Barack Obama, and it can only be topped by if Hillary Clinton comes into power.
Right.
And I think she may make things even 10 times worse than Barack Obama. I don't know where I come up with 10 times, maybe 2 times. Even if she's equally as bad as Obama, we're in terrible
trouble.
Trouble.
Exactly.
But well, Donald Trump had something to say via Twitter after this was announced today. I think he probably tweeted what most people think, saying that the system is rigged. Let's listen to what Trump had to say from other people's perspective.
Trump took about 20 minutes to make his first reaction. At least we understand it to be his first reaction. He sent out this tweet after hearing from the FBI director, quote, the system is rigged. General Petraeus got in trouble for far less. Very, very unfair. As usual, bad judgment. Bad judgment, and as you pointed out, Greg, the FBI director said it was something worse than that.
Yeah, I mean, he used the definition of gross negligence that is commonly employed by judges explaining to jurors what gross negligence mean by it means being seriously or extremely careless. And so now where does this go? It obviously is referred to the Department of Justice. Generally, they kind of rubber stamp what the FBI recommends. After all, a lot of FBI agents are lawyers. And Director Comey is a former federal prosecutor. He was the U.S. attorney in New York. And so they take seriously when they say, we don't recommend prosecution. Who will make the decision? Loretta Lynch, the attorney general, has said, although she's not recusing herself, that she won't overturn the FBI's recommendation. So likely it'll be a decision by the Assistant Attorney General Leslie Caldwell or the Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates. Now, both are loyal Democrats and Democratic appointees. So Donald Trump's tweet here may ring true to a great many people that the system is rigged because the two people who will make the final decision are both loyal Democrat appointees. John?
And he's just out with a second tweet. The FBI director said, crooked Hillary, this is quoting Donald Trump, crooked Hillary compromised our national security, no charges, wow. And then the hashtag rigged system. Greg Jarrett, thanks very much for picking apart the law for us on this point. Thanks, Greg.
Again, Trump just said what a huge percentage of the population believe, that the system is rigged. We know if anybody would have done that, they would have been prosecuted. Mm-hmm. You at least, any prosecutor would think, we got to send this before a jury. We got to do our best. We don't have, I think it's a slam dunk case. I don't even think it's a hard case. And for him to come out and say that there was not enough evidence to show that she intentionally did what she did, you don't have to intentionally do. I believe she did intentionally do. If she didn't intentionally do it, why did she delete over 30,000 emails? That looks kind of suspicious.
Yeah.
That's admissible evidence. That would be put in and allowed that that happened. If she wasn't guilty, why did her husband meet with the attorney general last week on an airplane in secret? That's admissible evidence.
Yeah, what's the purpose of that, you know?
I mean, I'm not even a lawyer, and I think I could win this case. And we get the attorney general. Went on, it was real tough for her to go on record saying that she wouldn't make the final decision, or she would defer to career law, you know, law enforcement, and et cetera, et cetera. Except the recommendation ultimately has to be approved in the Justice Department. And if she defers, her two assistants are politically appointed lifelong Democrats.
Imagine that.
And let's see. Are we going to be loyal to Hillary? Or not? That's kind of like saying, do we want to live or do we want to die? Oh, I didn't insinuate that people that cross the Clintons die. I didn't insinuate, did I?
No, not at all.
I seen something on Facebook today, and it was on Facebook, so we know it's true.
Absolutely.
That actually what James Comey was doing with his eyelashes when he was up there was making Morse code for, I'm afraid of dying if I say anything else. I mean, you don't cross the Clintons. It's a known fact. And we know that she's a liar. She's been proven many, many times.
Oh, dozens of times that she's a liar.
I hit the wrong sound bite. Oh. Where'd it go? Oh. My timing was horrible. I was trying to hit my sound bite right in cue, and I hit the wrong one. I guess God wants us to know that he's not dead, because that's what I hit. God's not dead. And no matter who's in the White House, God's still not dead.
Absolutely.
And even if Hillary makes it, which, oh my gosh, I can't even stand the thought of those words coming out of my mouth, God will still be in charge, whether she likes it or not. And we may wonder if God's still in charge if she wins the White House, but she will be, or he will be. Again, I say, we know she lies.
But the lie detector determined that was a lie. But the lie detector determined that was a lie.
Thank you, Trevor. We have the Hillary Clinton button now. No matter what we're talking about, if we realize that somebody's lying, we can now say...
But the lie detector determined that was a lie.
Not for me.
We'll just call it the Hillary Clinton button. I was... the song that says... I know you're lying because your lips are moving.
Yep.
It was on in the car the other day, and my two grandkids were with me. And I said, this song's about Obama. And they said, what do you mean? I said, I know you're lying because your lips are moving. And they looked at me like I was goofy. And I said, that means if he's talking, he's lying because he don't tell the truth. And I'm sure that the UN would think that was bad, that I was indoctrinating my grandchildren. But since when did I give a flip about what the United Nations
exactly
thinks? So I guess it could be called the Obama button too, but we're going to use it since our focus is on making sure that Hillary Clinton does not get into the White House by any means necessary that is legal.
I'm so glad you put that is legal in.
Yeah, we have plenty of helicopters go by since we have a military facility not too far from us. We don't want black ones coming over. Swooping down and... I mean, we're armed... But we're not that armed.
Not that armed.
No, we're not that armed. Maybe we
need to... We're armed, but not to take on a helicopter. Well, I don't know, though.
Maybe we need to be that armed.
We ought to be.
I'm talking her language now. Notice, she gonna beat
up. I lit up.
She gonna get up and beat on her chest a few times. That's right, we ought to be.
You're
nuts. Me, Tarzan. You, Jane, we're armed.
That's right. You're not with just a little drunk monkey.
No, we're not just armed with little anything.
That's exactly right.
So we find out that she is extremely careless. One person made the joke, Gmail should have an option where you could mark an email classified. There's a picture of her in an orange jump or a pantsuit that
should
she's wearing.
Jumpsuit.
Yeah. And
orange jail jumpsuit.
Well, the joke with this tweet is, turns out this is the only time you will see Hillary in an orange jumpsuit. I bet she didn't wear that anymore.
I bet not.
There's a picture of saying, I don't care, and the tweet says, whenever I see news about Hillary Clinton in email. Well, you really should care. Here's somebody from the other side. Republicans' indignation is pathetic. Bush Cheney haven't even been charged with war crimes, but they want to put Clinton in prison for careless emailing.
Careless emailing.
Let's see.
Oh, my heavens.
Giving secrets to the enemy is known as...
I think that's called treason.
Treason. That's even worse than that number that they would had given of what statute that she broke. Something F. Imagine that. She played the F card. I ain't even going to comment on it. Just going to say... Man, I think I hurt my chest.
I bet you did. You pounded pretty hard.
I'm bruised.
You're bruised?
I took one for the show.
I thought you were going to put yourself in cardiac arrest.
You'd give me mouth-to-mouth, wouldn't you?
Baby, I'd do that whether you needed it or not.
Oh, okay. Well, you would think that on a day where she was busted, just not arrested for it, she would have been... I think I'd have gone quiet for a little bit.
No, she's proud of herself. She got away with what she did.
The headline of this story says, an arrogant Obama, that's what we were talking about earlier, and crooked Hillary take to North Carolina rally stage to mock... Take to North Carolina rally stage to mock their critics. Clinton's chances of winning the White House hinge on rallying Obama's coalition to her cause. Obama's legacy depends on her success. 8 years after they spent millions of dollars tearing each other down in pursuit of the White House, they now spend countless words and 4 months selling each other to the public, writes Associated Press analyst Julie Pace. So 4 or 8 years ago, they spent millions of dollars to try to outdo the other. And now they're going around giving speeches together. I caught this in something earlier that I read, and then I read it here. Crooked Hillary took to the stage today to mock and belittle her critics. In her opening remarks, she blasted Donald Trump, all of his followers, conspiracy theorists, patriots, and everyone who thinks she should be going to jail for her private email server scandal. Oh, yeah. Promised everyone free college if they vote for her in November and said that was Obama's idea. And then this says, feeling the burn yet? She's picked up on the Bernie Sanders idea of free college for everyone. Barack Obama likes that.
Mm-hmm.
Some might ask, why is President Obama allowed to use Air Force One on the campaign trail with Crooked Hillary? She's flying with him. Who pays? That was a tweet from Donald Trump. Many believe it's a point well taken. However, I read another story that says anywhere the president goes, it has to be by Air Force One, and that the political campaigns have to pay a portion of those expenses. That's code speak for we the people paid for part of that trip.
Oh, I'm sure we the people paid for all of that trip.
The article that I read said that the DNC said that they would pay the appropriate fees for what was done. Look, I know you could say the same thing about every president before. They have to travel by Air Force One. But it does make you kind of just crawl that Hillary Clinton is going around the country now with Barack Obama. And you might say, well, it's just one trip to North Carolina. Let's see how many more it is. This is the first. That's the accurate statement.
Right.
This is the first time. Well, I have spent much of the show talking about a sound clip that I have to play. Let's see what I got left, if I got anything else left other than this one. Oh, I do. I have two sound clips. This is not the one I've been talking. Well, we have referenced a couple times. Listen to Barack Hussein Obama from this same rally that we've been talking about the last few minutes.
Got an opinion. But nobody actually knows the job until you're sitting behind the desk. Everybody can tweet, but nobody actually knows what it takes to do the job until you sat behind the desk. I mean, Sasha tweets, but she doesn't think that she's thereby should be sitting behind the desk. So you can't fully understand what it means to make life and death decisions until you've done it. That's the truth. But I can tell you this. Hillary Clinton has been tested. She has seen up close what's involved in making those decisions. She has participated in the meetings in which those decisions have been made. She's seen the consequences of things working well and things not working well. And there has never been any man or woman more qualified for this office than Hillary Clinton. Ever. And that's the truth. That's the truth. So the bottom line is, I know Hillary can do the job. And that's why I am so proud, North Carolina, to endorse Hillary Clinton as the next president of the United States.
What a piece of arrogance he is.
Yes, he is.
Making Sasha can tweet, talking about his daughter. And of course he was referencing the tweets that Donald Trump had put out earlier in the day. Couldn't get by without the arrogance there. We talked about it, then we actually had audio to prove
back it up
what we said. I mean, if you deny that that was arrogance, you really out of touch, because he's as arrogant as anybody during my lifetime.
Absolutely.
That's ever been in the White House. I can't say of all time, because I've only lived since the 60s. And he actually sounded like he was a preacher, you know, trying to give a sermon up front. And, oh, well, he would fail miserably, because even though he claims to be a Christian, we all know what he truly is on the inside.
Well, absolutely.
He's a lying African.
That's exactly right. A lion African.
And
not an African lion, but a lion African.
What we're making reference to is that there was a 4th of July parade in a city in Indiana yesterday, and a guy that puts an entry into this parade every year. And by the way, last year his entry was a transgender clown or something like that.
Yeah.
So he's not like Mr. Conservative everything. His entry this year, the front part of it said African lion, and it was a picture of a lion. And on the back was a picture of Obama, and it said lying African.
He was in a toilet.
Yeah, he was in a
toilet. Coming up out of a toilet, or going down in a toilet. I don't know.
And boy, there's been a lot of people upset over that. I have a feeling that next year in the parade they will scrutinize his entry or not allow him to be in.
Not allow him to be in. I'm sure after all that he's gotten today.
You know that First Amendment only works if you say what people want you to say.
Exactly.
So that's where the lion African line come in. For all of you people that want to just jump down the Ed Boston Podcast Network's throat, we were making reference to a story that was real. So there, take that. Lion pieces of garbage.
Snap.
Okay, now this one that I've referenced several times. It's 6 minutes long, and I thought about cutting it up, and when I listen to it all the way through, I want the listeners to just be patient, because it's important. The first about 3 minutes and 40 seconds, I could have cut it off there. It was a good cutoff point, and I started to do that. But then they talk some more, and then the point at the very end I made reference to earlier in the show, and I want you to hear what Rudy Giuliani has to say for the next 6 minutes and 30 seconds.
The man you've all been waiting to hear from, Rudy Giuliani. So I want to talk to you about this because obviously Director Comey has decided not to, or in fact saying that no reasonable prosecutor would recommend that this case would go forward against Hillary Clinton. Your thoughts?
My thoughts are that it would be unreasonable for a prosecutor not to go forward with it, and almost an abdication of duty. What Elizabeth has just laid out under 18 U.S.C. Section 793 is what we would call a no-brainer back in the U.S. Attorney's Office that Jim Comey belonged to. He was one of my assistants. It does not require intent. It just requires gross negligence. He said during his long statement that she was extremely careless. The first definition of gross negligence that comes up, if you take out the legal dictionary, is being extremely careless.
Yeah, and that's the problem. People at home want to know, what is this distinction? Is it a distinction without a difference? Because a lot of people hear this. I mean, we're both former prosecutors.
Sure. So,
why wouldn't it go forward?
Well, the minute you say someone is extremely careless, you are saying they're grossly negligent. That is what a judge will charge a jury.
Mm-hmm.
The judge will charge a jury, has the government proven that she was extremely careless? What do we mean by gross negligence? We mean extremely careless. Regular negligence is not using the proper degree of care under the circumstances.
Sure.
Gross negligence is being extremely careless in exercising your responsibilities. That's what Jim Comey found. He then just didn't come to the conclusion that it's a violation of the statute. He came to the other conclusion. I think that's why he walked out. There's no way to square the two things.
Isn't that interesting? Because he was potentially going to take questions.
People were waiting,
and he left.
That's the first question that would have been asked. Second question would have been, would she pass an FBI background check for top security clearance?
Right.
The answer is no.
No.
She couldn't possibly. Well, I've read 1,000 FBI background checks, maybe 2,000. This would get thrown right in the ash can. I mean, she wouldn't be, you know, the number 35 person at the State Department. We wouldn't hire her as an assistant U.S. attorney with this record.
Yes, she would fail the background check based on the standards that have been used for years.
Based on what he said. If you took his report and made it an FBI background check, she couldn't get any kind of sensitive job with the government of the United States. And finally, and you know this, we never prove intent with direct evidence. Very rarely does somebody say, I'm going to trade on inside information, or I'm going to pay this bribe. We do it with circumstantial evidence. Well, the circumstantial evidence here was overwhelming. He laid it all out. I thought he was going to come to the conclusion that she was going to be indicted. And here's the biggest piece of circumstantial evidence, the destruction of the 34,000 emails. He would have been entitled under these facts to a charge to the jury that from the destruction of the emails, you can infer guilty knowledge.
Like consciousness of guilt.
Consciousness of guilt.
And that's
like
a power, powerful instruction.
The instruction on fleeing. If someone flees, you get a charge that is evidence of guilty knowledge. If someone destroys records that are possibly relevant, and these records have to be possibly relevant. They actually found some of these records to be relevant. He would have gotten that charge to the jury. So Jim has kind of turned it around. A reasonable prosecutor would have brought this case, no doubt. And I don't know how he ever is going to be able to charge anybody in the CIA or the FBI that is extremely careless with top secret information if he isn't charging Hillary Clinton. I mean, this is the special exception for the Clintons.
Right, because the bar is so high now in terms of the requisite level of proof is what you're suggesting, because he's saying no reasonable prosecutor would bring this forward. I found that language to be very
absurd.
Specific and, yeah, it was an absurd.
Language is absurd. Reasonable prosecutors would bring this, and certainly under 18 U.S.C. Section 793, that would be the conservative way to go. The more challenging way to go would be to take all of this evidence of what she was doing, her destruction of emails, and use it as evidence of guilty knowledge. I'm pretty sure that's the way I would do it, and I don't have any doubt I could win this case in front of a jury.
Well, there you go. And now with something else that was interesting to me when we're sitting here watching this and people watching at home, he talked about her attorneys and the counsel that, in fact, removed, deleted some of these emails. They weren't able to get access to them. And then they were not recoverable because they said they purged and cleaned their devices in a way that they are no longer able to get them.
Giving these documents to them, by the way, was a violation of 793.
Just that in and of itself.
That in and of itself was a violation of 793. Look, I worked in the Justice Department for 15 years. For four or five of those years, I had a high security clearance. And I would approve FISA applications.
Sure.
For national security. I never left the Justice Department with him. I stayed until 4 in the morning, and I locked him in the safe. If I had done something like this, there is no doubt in my mind the next Justice Department or my... I would have been indicted. I'd have been indicted for it. It is so discouraging to someone who loves the Justice Department.
Yeah.
To see a decision like this.
You fought your whole life for justice.
I am so disappointed in this. And I brought cases against the Teamsters Union during the 1988 election when it did serious damage to the Republican Party. Gosh almighty, you know, you just put that out of your mind. You put all that stuff out of your mind. She violated 18 U.S.C. Section 793. Now, the interesting thing is the statute of limitations will not have run on this. And if Trump should win and appoint an attorney general who's got the courage to do it, they could bring this indictment.
That's a significant point that nobody's made today. That's why the world's been waiting to hear from you for sure on this. And a lot of people upset, obviously, because they said, look at the different standard applying because of David Petraeus, the trouble that he got into.
She should at least resign as a candidate on the grounds that if she can't pass a top security clearance, she can't be president of the United States.
Right. And now the American people will decide. Always a pleasure to have
you.
Thank you so much for coming on The Real Story. And as we were saying,
if she can't pass a security clearance, she shouldn't be the president of the United States. That's just a big duh. If you can't pass a security clearance, how do we give you the nuclear codes?
Exactly.
To start World War III or the end of civilization as we know it? Not that Hillary Clinton wants to end the world. But how could you be trusted with it?
Wow.
I mean, we know that Bill, he lost it one time. So, yeah. Rudy Giuliani, I'm not a huge Rudy Giuliani fan. I loved what he did in New York during 9/11.
Oh, I did too.
Yeah, I mean, he proved leadership qualities that many people don't have.
Absolutely.
But he is by far no strong right-wing conservative. He's very moderate on a lot of his policies. I never wanted him to be president because I think he's too far to the middle. But he's a career law enforcement justice person. And I respect what he has to say, and he did say quite a bit that made a lot of sense. You know, there's a reason that the director of the FBI, James Comey, just set out a case and then said he wasn't going to do anything about it. The question is what caused that?
Yeah, wow.
What caused it? Folks, no Hillary in the White House by any legal means necessary. We're going to wrap things up with a song reminding us that Jesus comes to us with his arms wide open. And we're going to get out of here. So for everyone, this is Ed.
And Amy.
We're going to say goodnight and go out and do the right thing.
Stream down my face with arms wide.